How would you like an electric shock? Chances are you'd rather pass, which is fair enough. We all know that as useful as electricity is in our day-to-day lives, it can also be extremely dangerous. So the idea of deliberately applying it to your brain might strike you as rather foolhardy. But what if it turned out that done in the right way, this might not only be perfectly safe, but actually good for your mental health, and might even make you smarter? Unbelievable as that may sound, these are the benefits currently being pursued in the rapidly expanding field of neurostimulation. The key insight behind this technology is that while electricity might seem like something best kept outside our bodies, it's actually essential to how they function and malfunction. Our brains orchestrate everything we do through electrical signals, and if those get disrupted, things start to go wrong, causing a host of medical conditions. In the 1930s, this basic understanding led to the development of electroconvulsive therapy, or ECT, in which a strong current performs a kind of hard reset of the brain's electrical systems. While obviously an unsettling prospect, ECT can actually be very effective for major depression, but still, it's a pretty crude way of treating a highly complex organ. These days, we know far more about how specific brain activity relates to different conditions. For example, which regions are overactive in anxiety or underactive in depression. And this improved understanding, combined with more precise techniques, has paved the way for a new generation of treatments. There are many different kinds of neurostimulation, but two are rapidly going mainstream. One is transcranial magnetic stimulation, or TMS, in which a pulsing magnetic field interacts with the brain's electrical fields to start or stop neurons firing. The other is transcranial direct current stimulation, or TDCS, which, like ECT, involves passing electricity between electrodes on the scalp, except with a current 400 times weaker, making it barely noticeable. Instead of forcing neurons to activate, TDCS simply adjusts their readiness to do so, nudging them back towards the desired level of connectivity. Among the best-studied conditions for these treatments is depression, with trials consistently showing that with repeated use, both methods can help rebalance disrupted brain circuitry, leading several public health bodies to approve them for use. But that's just the beginning. Researchers are also investigating a range of common illnesses, as different as Alzheimer's, chronic pain, OCD, tinnitus, various addictions, eating disorders, and long COVID. Some of this research is still in early stages, with more studies needed to determine how well different conditions respond to different methods, and how long the improvements last. But the good news is that the small currents involved make these forms of brain stimulation simpler to administer than ECT. So much so that direct current stimulation can be done at home by patients themselves. And private companies are already putting such headsets on the market. But while this technology could be revolutionary for mental health care, it might also have a big impact elsewhere. For some years now, so-called biohackers have been taking on the risks of experimenting with DIY neurostimulation as a means to upgrade their cognitive abilities. The idea is that by putting the brain in a more active state, it can more easily make the connections needed to focus, learn, remember, and solve problems. And although this began as a fringe subculture, the idea has been studied academically and has even piqued the interest of the US military. While the evidence for these kinds of off-label uses is, so far, patchier than that for mental health treatments, there's enough to suggest that gentle stimulation really can enhance cognitive performance. Now, that's worth pausing over, because the prospect of buying technology to improve our brain function could represent a major cultural shift and pose some serious questions. If wealthier families can give their kids brain-boosting devices, should less well-off children be given them too? Could bosses demand their employees wear neurostimulating headgear on the job? Should competitive use of these devices be regulated? And if so, how? Part of the problem here is that neurostimulation is an incredibly broad term, referring to a host of different technologies using different techniques to impact different brain regions for different purposes. So drawing any generalizations about when and how it can or should be used will inevitably be difficult. Regardless of these uncertainties, though, there's clearly a desperate need for a greater range of effective mental health treatments, and neurostimulation could be a powerful asset in that that arena, especially if it enables people to treat themselves non-invasively at home on their own schedule. As the body of research grows, we're likely to see a steady rise in the use of this technology, both for therapeutic purposes and for self-enhancement. So we need to start thinking about the implications now, before brain stimulation headsets become just another piece of gadgetry we don't give a second thought.